beautiful thing. And then like, what else can you do?
I feel like finding the dots, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
how you've done everything.
Happy New Year, everybody. This is going to be a great year. First of all, let's say hi to the world because, you know, there's a few hundred people watching online live right now. Hi, world. Happy New Year to the world. Yeah, so this is the first event of 2020 here. The first of 82 that are booked right now. It might go up a little bit. We know that it will. And it's going to be a special one because I don't believe I could describe it because I don't really know enough about what's going to happen to tell you, which is good because then you can see what's happening. I think that a lot of it is visual and you might want to see what she's doing. So you make sure that your seat allows you to see what she's doing to take the full benefit of it. Now, talking about multi-sensory experiences, because this is going to be one, right? Most of our events are, at least audio and visual. But we had an extra sense on February 13th. So there's going to be, the food is going to match. So Muriel Anderson is coming. She's a harp guitar virtuoso. She's been here before once. She's world renowned and she's been traveling the world, and she actually published a cookbook from her world travels. And she wrote songs that go with each recipe. So she's going to play songs, project images from the place where the recipe came from. And so it's going to be audio, visual, and taste. So that should be cool. And the benefit, like the bonus of it, is that you guys or the audience are going to be doing the cooking. So we're going to send you the recipe. We're going to give you the recipes and, you know, kind of try and make sure that not everyone does the same recipe. And then that's going to be it. So it should be an interesting experience. It's a first for us. As far as I know, I don't remember ever matching food with...
That sounds like a great Valentine's event with your partner.
Well, yeah, exactly. I'm just saying. Whatever. Valentine's is a fabricated... I'm just kidding. So now, let's go and let's talk about tonight. First of all... we had the reception, but let's present and introduce the artist for tonight, Patrick Tafoya, everybody. He's going to come up here. Now, Patrick has shown here before several times. In fact, if I had a spotlight, I could show you his artwork that it hangs permanently in the house on the second floor. We've got Keith Jarrett, Miles Davis, and we've got Jimi Hendrix there. You've got Miles in the bathroom that's been there for many years as well. And that's a print, and he's got some prints, other copies of that series for sale here. So that those are the more affordable options if you're looking to buy art tonight. $89.90.
$89 for lithograph prints.
Yeah.
Oh, the Miles Davis pointillism pen and ink drawing that's in the bathroom, and you can see it up here.
Yeah, and that's just pointillism. That's pretty cool.
And if they all sell out, you can place your orders.
Yes, yes. And, some of his larger pieces are obviously more expensive, but you're going to talk to him about that. There are some in the $1,000 range, and then these bigger ones are obviously more expensive. Now, the cool thing is that he's going to paint live three times during his residency. That's the new model we've adopted, and it works really well. But the special thing with Patrick is that this is going to be a triptych. So he's going to make three paintings in his three appearances here this month. And so if you're interested in buying the triptych, you're going to have to kind of like put your down payment and wait until it gets finished, right? Because you're only going to see one of them tonight, and then the second one, and then the third one. So that's pretty cool. Anything else you'd like to tell people why you paint? And well, actually, those sculptures are cool too.
Three-dimensional pieces too.
Which I should get out of the way.
I don't really have any specific description of my work, but I enjoy it. It's been a lifelong hobby for me, and it's obviously I paint to help pay the bills too. So I do my best at everything I do, but most of the things here are abstract. But I do enjoy doing figurative and portraiture and sculpture, three-dimensional pieces too. I have other three-dimensional pieces that are metal and wood and abstract, so I like to enjoy all.
This one's not finished, I understand.
No, that's not. That's still, the face is finished, but I still have work to do on the back. But that is actually a gift to my wife, so that can't be for sale.
That is not for sale. And I can tell you, for having moved it earlier, that it is...
It's
a significant piece of work.
it's
pretty heavy.
It's pretty heavy.
Yes. Yeah.
About 300 pounds.
It is beautiful. So, that piece, right? So, and I think that Sarah is going to actually might be projecting shadows while she plays on it. That was the idea I tried, but sometimes I may be wrong. It might not work. Anyways, thank you, Patrick. So, he's such a good friend of the Tim Aquinas Foundation. Thank you very much. And I just want to tell you a little bit about our schedule. There's a couple of standout events you will not want to miss. One of them, for example, is March 2nd, is the Manhattan Chamber Players. If you're interested in chamber music, this is like a world leader in mixed ensemble chamber music, so you don't want to miss that. And there's might be a couple of surprises there about, you know, when that comes, which we cannot say because it would ruin the surprise. And as far as the seats, you saw the slide probably or hopefully earlier, but we had sponsors and that made the seats possible. Michael Levine is here. He's one of the sponsors. Yes. And thank you. And other projects. And I scored my maintenance budget sponsor for the year. Dr. Boger is going to sponsor the instrument maintenance for the year, $2,000. I'm so happy about that. And we, you may know that we scored the canopy over the patio with that back there, so that when it rains, you will no longer be in the rain. So you'll be protected from the elements. So that's pretty cool. And our next projects are the lighting projection and the acoustic control system. So if you're interested in helping out and you would like your name, you know, associated with one of these projects, we'd love to do that. And the plaques are coming. You're going to see plaques for the seats, and I'm going to put a nice big plaque there for the instrument maintenance. Now, a little bit of housekeeping. Please silence your cell phone unless, Elizabeth, you insist on having some impromptu, you know, participation and contributions from ringtones. But please silence your cell phone and disable your flash. You're welcome to take pictures and share them on Instagram and whatnot. You can, you know, check in on Facebook or whatever social media and say, hey, I'm at this very cool place and I'm having a great time. What is that? Oh, we've got merchandise for sale. Elizabeth has merchandise for sale, so please take a look at that. That's actually this week's project, is that new merchandise area is coming up this week. So next time you come, it's gonna happen. Now, we have a magical bowl that is there that has been modeled by Wendy. And it's magical in the sense that it's empty or almost empty now. And before you leave, it's gonna be full of cash. And so that's a very magical bowl, and we need that money in the bowl because that's how we pay the musicians. And yes, anything else? The glasses, when you're done, bring them back to the bar, and everything else. First of all, everything we gave you as far as like cutlery and whatnot is all compostable, so that goes in the bins in the lobby. And you may have noticed also that the first bathroom is more spacious now for people in the wheelchair. And that's thanks to Larissa Nelson, so thank you very much for the sponsor for that. Anything else I need to say? That's it. I've been too long already. I'm getting the evil eye. So please help me welcome Elizabeth Baker.
Cool. Sarah's going to stay down there for a second so I can attempt to explain what is happening here. Because it's not a normal concert by any shape of the imagination. So I've really been interested lately in this concept of three-dimensional objects that are then represented in two-dimensional space that are then interpreted in non-space things, so sound and movement. And that came mostly because of our phones and Facebook and all of those things. And I'm a person who I have a lot of thoughts, obviously. I don't know anyone that's just making illuminated manuscript an instrument. That's not normal. And so I am able to express myself through writing very well. But once somebody wants to debate something with me on Facebook, I feel a ton of anxiety and I have a hard time expressing myself. But if we were having a conversation normally, it would be simple for me to do so. So I am a person that gets very overwhelmed by the internet if it's not me researching something for a specific reason. And the concept of like images coming in front of you all the time that you have to interpret, and a lot of images that you have had no experience with. So through the internet, you can experience surfaces and places that you have never had experience with. And on top of that, as if that wasn't enough, I also have a very big interest in objects and the identity of objects. And does an object have an identity because of its usefulness, or is it always something that has an identity that's separate from what we assign it? And that's what these pieces tonight are all based on. So the first one is surface studies, which is, it's actually surface studies, Insta-Meta. So it's an iteration of surface studies. So surface studies and object studies are not one single piece. It's a bunch of iterations delving into this thesis, hypothesis, concept of what is a surface, what is an object, and what does it mean to the person who is taking in that data. So surface studies today is going to deal also with my interest in disruptive technologies, because the most disruptive technology that you have in your pocket is the most disruptive thing that's been created in the last century. And it's completely changed the way that we live and our attention span and the way that we interact with each other or don't interact with each other. And it also has changed the way that our minds piece together information. So everything is a sonic ritual of sorts. So I'll explain the sonic ritual of surface studies, and then probably I will explain to you object studies. Well, we're gonna go there together. Okay, so surface studies, the performer is given a surface, like an image of a surface. That image can be on film, it can be on paper, it can be any two-dimensional representation. So for this, I will be using instant cameras, phones, and iPad to give information to Sarah, who is graciously going to fulfill the role of performer. There's two roles in this piece, the role of curator, which I will be performing, and the role of performer. So the performer receives these materials at the discretion of the curator, and they're reacting to it. It's not the attempt to make something beautiful and pretty, and I'm not interested in that. What I'm interested in is how our mind reacts to stimuli and how it reacts when that stimuli is disrupted. And that's what this piece in practice goes into. And I'll probably take a moment to, like, after we finish surface studies, to explain object studies, because I feel like I gave everyone a lot of stuff to chew on for surface studies. So if you could help me welcome Sarah Morrison. Sarah's going to be facing not you, because it's not about you. If, depending on where you are, you might be able to see some of the things she's reacting to. But yeah. And I'm pretty sure this is not going to work, but I'm going to try it. Was like the second thing that I created in this series about two-dimensional representation, three-dimensional objects that are then interpreted by a sound or movement artist. So in object studies, you have an object. Tonight, we will be doing an iteration of obsolete data. The sad part is that because I'm saying these things instead of like showing you, you don't get to see the fancy camel case that I write all these in. Camel case is the fancy term for coding. So it's like a lowercase, an uppercase. So there's going to be two performances of object studies. So object studies, the initial process of it is that you do an illuminated manuscript of an object. For obsolete data, they're all forms of technology that either sent or received or stored data that are now obsolete, which I really enjoyed because as a child of the 80s, these were all things that I saw very often because my parents own their own business and it's really fun and boring. They sell and service copiers, fax machines, and shredders. So I lived in an office. And yeah, so I have all of these weird things like 8-inch floppy disk. I love the smell of carbon paper, so there's things like that. And my dad was one of the first adopters of these cell phones. The antenna is missing, but it's not like it's gonna work. hey, don't knock it. So my secret, it's on the internet, but it's also public knowledge. You should know how your taxpayer dollars are being spent. My parents worked at CENCOM when I was in middle school. And in the middle of the CENCOM giant, like concrete monolith that no cell signal can get through, this phone could get through for me to be like, hey dad, I'm done with school. Someone needs to come pick me up. I know you're locked in a government facility and can't come get me, but maybe you can call someone to get me. So he had some of these and I told him I wanted to use them for this purpose. So I just remember these classic Motorola phones and I have so much fun. So today I'm going to create an illuminated manuscript, definition or description of this Motorola brick phone. And so that then becomes a letter. And the letter is a score for someone who would be doing a different version of surface studies. And in this case, that different version is portrayed by me. So this is the object study that I did on October 28th, it's very precise, of last year. And it's of an 8-inch floppy disk. So this is what it looks like when you're done. And then I will be performing that on the piano. So I will be interpreting the surface of the floppy disk later. But for now, I will be interpreting the phone. And it's going through a bunch of processes. There are many computers and an iPad. That are picking up the sound that I'm making from doing illuminated manuscript, so it now becomes an instrument, this amplified surface, which is why I like to say I played the illuminated manuscript. And it's also going to use this fancy ring from Finland called the Wave. And so it is a wireless Bluetooth MIDI controller that tracks my movement and specific gestures cause it to react in specific ways. Yes. So that's pretty much it in a very cursory way. I would say this piece is, I really love the space that it creates and the dialogue that it creates, because a lot of times when we have music performance, we're expecting something, a spectacle of some sort. And instead, you guys are sort of experiencing a very sort of intimate moment and a quiet moment in a world that is often very loud. So, I've been seeing a lot of my pieces have been getting more quiet and spacious recently. And I suppose that's the only answer to bombs. Like, what's the opposite of bombs? Soft sounds. Oh, just in case, because I know, you know, with the piano, they're like, oh, that's the last note. They're like, what's the last thing for this? So I will be stamping the envelope with my wax seal, and that will be the end of the piece. The piece starts with fire. Sorry, Benoit. I will not burn the White House down. now I play the piano. I played the Illuminated Manuscript, now I play the piano.
Thank you. vaccination for anything that happened today. I'm here. I'll be eating food. So, yeah, ask me a question between mouthfuls.